we're going to talk about staying in the love walk. How many know we need to stay in the love walk? You know, the Bible says we walk by faith, we live by faith, but faith worketh through love. So we don't stay in the love walk, we can't stay in the faith walk. The two go together, amen? Faith works through love. That's Galatians 5:6, for in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision availeth anything, but faith working through love. Hallelujah. And we know that God doesn't just have love. God is love, isn't he? 1 John 4:8 says, he who does not love does not know God, for God is love. Amen. Now, he's talking about a special kind of love. You know, people use that word love for all kind of different things. You know, oh, I love you. I love my dog. I love ice cream. And we could just go on and on and on the way we use that word love. But see, that's a special word of love. It means God kind of love. There's only one kind of God kind of love. It's called agape in the original language. It's agape love. It's the God kind of love. And where is that love at in the earth today? It's in the born again believers. Amen. So I trust it's in your heart today. If it's not, you can get it before you leave here today. And if you've had it so suppressed, you can get it up where it needs to be. Amen, in your life. You can put it on. Paul said, put on love. Like a coat. Like your clothes, you put it on. God, the God kind of love. Romans 5:5 says, now hope does not disappoint. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. And he's given to us in the new birth. Amen? He's poured out in our hearts in the new birth. But I'm telling you, he's also poured on us in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Did you know the baptism in the Holy Ghost is where Jesus baptizes the believer in the Holy Spirit? He's the baptizer. The Spirit of God's what we're baptized in there. He says you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, but you also receive love on you, the love of God, because God is love. The Holy Spirit is love. Amen. I'll always remember when I got the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Yeah, I spoke in tongues. I spoke in tongues most of the night. But I tell you what, I just felt love for everybody. I tell you, I was in business at the time, and I went to business there, you know, and the first one that come into my business was this Church of Christ guy. He come down there just every day to my business. I don't know whether he was trying to convert me or what, but, and boy, I just looked at that old boy, and I just the love of God went out to him. You know, and I called his name, and I said, I got the Holy Ghost. I got baptized in the Holy Ghost. I speak in tongues. He looked at me and said, well, that's good, Jack. Call me Jack. That's good, Jack. He didn't know what I was talking about, but he knew something had happened to me. See, people can argue doctrine with you, but they can't argue experience. Glory to God. Amen. Glory be to God. So you not only you get it poured out in your heart in the new birth, and then Jesus then pours it out on you when he baptizes you in the Holy Spirit. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Now you got to stay full. Amen. Now we won't take time to go there, but in 1 Corinthians chapter, I tell you what, this would be good for us to go there. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, see, gives us the characteristics of love. In other words, it's telling us what love ought to be doing, how love should operate. Amen? And I tell you what, it would just be good for all of us to every day read the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Because we need to continually be reminded of what this love of God that he has shed abroad in our hearts and he's baptized us in. What this love of God is supposed to be doing. Amen? So let's just pick up with verse 4 there. Begins to talk to us about love. It says, love suffers long and is kind. Well, you know, we all suffer long at times. But are we kind while we're doing it? That's where the challenge comes. Amen. You know, when you're hurting and you're suffering, whatever kind of suffering it may be, we're supposed, the love of God, you know, gives us the ability to be kind while we're doing it. Amen. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Isn't God wonderful? He's given us something like this. His love, really, he's given us himself, hadn't he? He's given us himself in the Holy Ghost. He's given us himself. Amen. So, now, this is interesting. Did you know what the first evidence that lets you know that you're saved? What's the first evidence that you have that lets you know you're saved? The Bible tells you what it is in 1 John 3:14. It says, we know. How many of you know? We're supposed to know this. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. Now, the word brethren there is a non-gender word. It means all the believers, men, women, children, all believers. We love the brethren, for he who does not love his brother abides in death. So it's not speaking in tongues. Amen. It lets us know we're saved. It's not paying our tithe. It's not running and jumping and shouting and praising the Lord, that's all good. It's loving the brethren, our fellow believers. Amen. Love is also called the fruit of the Spirit. Over in Galatians chapter 5. This is something good to read every day. Galatians chapter 5, beginning with verse 22, says, but the fruit of the Spirit, notice it's singular, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. The fruit of the Spirit is love, and out of love comes joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such, there's no law. Isn't that wonderful? Now, love should be growing. It can grow and will and should grow in our life. If there's no spiritual growth, then that means your love's not growing. Y'all need to get this. You need to get this. No spiritual growth without growing in love. In other words, spiritual growth stops when we stop walking in love. Think about that. If you're going to continue to grow and mature in Christ, you have to continue to walk in love. And as you walk in love, it grows. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If your life's dry, and we all go through dry times. Amen. But you're not supposed to let go of your love when you go through dry times. But so many Christians, when they start going through them dry times, they just let go of love. And they get real critical. You know? I don't know what's wrong with a preacher. I ain't getting nothing out of what he's saying. Well, you know something wrong with him right there, you know. No, I tell you what, if you get there, see, if you start getting critical, then you better do some spiritual checkup. You need a spiritual checkup. Amen? I Hallelujah. Now I want to talk about the biggest hindrance to the love walk. The biggest thing that'll get us out of the love walk than any other thing, according to the Word of God. I want us to turn over to Mark chapter 11. Let's read some scripture here that we all should be familiar with. Mark chapter 11, Jesus answered and said to his disciples here, he said to them, have faith in God. For surely I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. See, faith is that bridge that gets it out of the spirit into the natural. And I'm talking about the good things of God, the good promises of God. See, you got it spiritually in the new birth. You get it all because you're in Christ. It's not anything you've done. It's not anything you ever deserved. It's because you accepted what Jesus Christ did for you when he was hanging on that cross as your substitute, when he died and went to hell in your place as your substitute. And then when God raised him from the dead, the Bible says he's the firstborn from the dead. When God raised him from the dead for our justification. See, we got it all spiritually. Therefore, if any person be in Christ, they're new creatures. Well, you can't look in the mirror and say, well, I don't look new. I still don't have my hair. I thank God I still got a little, but I ain't got as much as I used to have. But it don't matter whether you got in the hair or not. He counted it. He counted it for you. You know why he counted it? You gonna get it back. In the resurrection, you're going to get it back. So don't be discouraged. You know, if you're losing some hair. I'm not losing. Mine's just turning gray. You either lose it or it turns gray. Amen? Now, I know you can doctor it up and do that, you know, make it look better. And, if you want to do that, that's all right with me, you know. Brother Hagin taught me in Bible school, you know, says, you know, old barn looks better with a little red paint on it. I think he was talking to the ladies then, I'm not sure, but. So, what are we looking for here? The biggest hindrance to our love walk and our faith walk. See, we walk by faith, but it's through what? Love. Agape love. Well, here what he said here in verse 25, it says, whenever you stand praying, if you have anything, I like what the King James says. King James says, ought. You know, you ought to do this or you ought not to do that, that kind of ought. He says, what things soever you stand praying, if you have aught, anything, that's what it means, anything, even these little bitty things, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. But if you don't forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. Woo! I believe I want to forgive, don't you? I believe I want to walk in love. Hallelujah. So, what we just read in the scripture lets us know that what we say does matter. Amen? We can hurt, we can wreck, we can ruin people with our mouths. You know, that's one reason I believe Jesus wants to baptize every believer in the Holy Ghost, because the Bible says that the tongue, and I dare say everybody in here's got one of them. If you don't have one of them, if you can't talk, you might be better off. I don't know that for a fact, but I mean, because I still got mine. But, you know, the Bible says the tongue is the most unruly member we have in our body. Of all these members in our body, the tongue is the most unruly member, and it says no man can tame it. And really, it implies it's full of hell. No man can tame it. But I tell you what, when you get immersed in the Holy Ghost and you stay filled with the Holy Ghost can tame your tongue. That's why I believe, that initial physical manifestation that lets us know we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost is speaking in other tongues. I believe he wants every believer speaking in other tongues. He wants every believer to have that prayer language where we can pray out the will of God for our lives. How can you do that? Because the Holy Ghost is giving you the words that you pray. Well, I don't understand them, Pastor. You don't have to understand them. Listen, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost understands it. Amen? It's your spirit with the help of the Holy Spirit praying unto the God who is spirit. You bypass that thing that keeps us in doubt. You bypass your natural mind. Amen. That's good. And your tongue is under control because you give it to the Holy Ghost. I think one of the problems is we don't pray in the Holy Ghost enough in the church. I'm just talking about this church. I'm talking about the church as a whole. Some of them don't even believe in it. Oughts in little things. That's why it says anything. It can be big or it can be real little. You know, I think it's over in the Psalms of Solomon, it says, the little foxes eat the vines. But, you know, look at the good news here. He says we can forgive when we stand praying. He's letting us know here how much unforgiveness hinders our praying in faith. Amen? See, we need to keep our hearts cleansed. Hearts need to be cleansed. Just think about how many times God has forgiven us. He wants us to forgive. What does forgive mean? It means to release it, let it go, cancel it. Cancel it, let it go. Because unforgiveness will make you pay. I heard Dr. Hagin say this. He said, anytime you feel mistreated, you can know the devil is working on you. You feeling mistreated here this morning? You can know the devil's working on you. You know, Jesus tells us to pray for our enemies. Amen? Bless those who curse you. I won't ask for a show of hands, but. See, the problem we all have and will have is keeping our hearts clean of those hurts that cause us not to walk in love. But we can get rid of them while we stand praying. And what does it take? It takes faith to forgive. Amen? I heard this story. You probably heard this story too. I probably told it before, but this man down in Brazil, him and his son had a lot of conflicts. His son left home and he didn't know where he was at and what he was doing. So he put a notice in the paper. His son's name was Paco. He put an ad in the Paco and says, Paco, I forgive you of everything. I want to reconcile with you. I want you to come home. And he said, I want you to meet me in such and such a place in the morning. And when he got there, there was 800 Pecos. You know what that tells us? Everybody needs forgiveness. Forgiveness. Amen. So we got to forgive the Pecos too. Amen. Hallelujah. See, Jesus, I want us to turn over to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 10. Jesus warns us of something here. It's very important we understand. Over here in Luke chapter 17, beginning with verse 1, Jesus spoke these words. I'm in John. Excuse me. Let me get over here where I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be in Luke chapter 17. I know it's probably on the board up there, but you ought to be looking in your Bibles if you got one. You know, putting the scriptures on the wall may be the worst thing we've ever done. See? Because people don't look it up in their Bibles. I still want my Bible. I don't even like these electronic Bibles. And maybe that's an age thing. I don't know. But I just want it there where I can turn the pages and I can know where this is and know where that is and I can go to it when I want to. Fumbling around on that thing trying to find it. I went to Ministerial Association. I didn't take my Bible with me. Shame, shame on the pastor. Of course, none of them take their Bibles, so you wouldn't think they believed in Bibles when you go to these ministerial meetings. And I got there. I hadn't been to several here in a while. But I went years, never missed one. I missed two, and they thought the world was coming to an end. But anyway, I got there. He always calls somebody ahead of time, you know, do a little devotion. And I got there, and he looked at me, and he said, Mr. President, he said, Brother Jackson, would you do the devotion for us today? I said, well, I didn't bring my Bible. And about three phones were handed to me. I said, well, I got my phone. I knew what scripture I wanted, and I took my phone. I kept fumbling around, and I finally couldn't just say. I said, well, I know what it says. And I know where it's at. So I did do the little short devotion there. But the reason I was able to do it, because I knew where it was at and I knew what it said. Amen. Glory to God. If you want to use your phone, that's fine, as long as you know where it's at and what it says. You know, back when Jesus was there, they had scrolls. Boy, technology's come a long way, hasn't it? They had to roll them scrolls out and read it. And he only had the Old Testament because he was fulfilling the new one for us. Him and the rest of them, his apostles later, Paul and Peter and John, all of them. So we got the better covenant now with better promises. Amen? Glory to God. Okay. All right, let's find, I found it here. It says, then he said to his disciples, it is impossible that no offense should come. But woe to him through whom they may come. It would be better for him if a milestone were hung around his neck and he was thrown into the sea that he should offend one of these little ones. He's talking about the children there. Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. And the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. So the Lord said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to this, now it says mulberry tree, but really the King James gets it right because it says sycamine tree. Now, the sycamine tree is in the mulberry tree family. But it had a specific name. It was called the sycamine tree. And it was a mulberry-type tree. But it wasn't like the mulberry trees that we know here in America. It was native to the Mideast situation there in Israel at that time, and still is to this time. Amen. Now, Jesus here, if you have faith as a mustard, you can say to this sycamine tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Now, what is he doing here? He is comparing bitterness and unforgiveness with this sycamine tree. You got a sycamine tree? I'm going to show you what a sycamine tree is, the reason he made this comparison between bitterness and unforgiveness with the sycamine tree. And listen, we've all have sycamine trees, or we've had sycamine trees, or we're going to have some. And I'm sick of mine. I hope you're sick of yours. So let's look at five characteristics of the sycamine tree that Jesus is comparing bitterness and unforgiveness with here. And we can learn something about bitterness and unforgiveness from this sycamine tree. Number one, it grows in dry places. It grows in desert dry places. So you got to really be careful when you're going through them dry times in your life that we all experience. Because that's when them things can really grow. Them sycamine trees that Jesus is comparing to bitterness and unforgiveness. You know, when you get into bitterness and unforgiveness, you're in a dry place. You're in a dry place. And you stay there long enough and you'll grow a crop of sycamine trees. There was a sycamore tree too, but we're talking about sycamine trees. Number two, it has a very large root structure. A very large root structure. Show that next slide there. I think we got a picture of that thing, that tree. There you go. Sometimes what's underground is far deeper than what's on top. What's growing down in you? This thing has very large, deep root structures, the deepest roots of any tree in that area of the world over there. Well, roots of bitterness go deep into your mind, your emotions, your health, your relationship, and even your finances. And Jesus is telling us here, it must be plucked up by the roots. If you're going to get rid of it, you got to pluck it up by the roots. You can't just cut it off even with the ground. You got to get the roots out. Because that sycamine tree, its roots would go down so deep that it would find water. Even in dry places, it would find water. And if they just cut it off at the ground, it would begin to grow back because it was getting the nourishment out of the ground and the water out of the ground that it needed. Very difficult to kill. Hot weather and blistering temperatures had little effect on this tree because it was tapped into a water source down deep under the earth. Cut it off at the ground, it only came back. And And this is what's happened so many times with bitterness and forgiveness in the lives of people. They think they've gotten rid of it, but the roots are still there. He says you got to pull it up by the roots and cast it into the sea. The sea of God's forgiveness. Amen. Hallelujah. Of course, salt water, cast it into the sea of salt water and it'd kill it. Salt water would kill it. Amen. Well, you know, I believe time's going to take care of this, Pastor, if I just give it enough time. No, no. More time you give it, the more them roots are growing. See? You got to pull it up by the roots and cast it into the sea. Hallelujah. All right, number three here, the third characteristics about this sycamine tree. It's the preferred wood for building caskets. You say, where are you getting all this information, Pastor? I'm getting it from Rick Renner. Pretty good source. And you can Google it and get all kind of information similar to this about them sycamine trees. Amen. Bitterness and unforgiveness grows caskets. In other words, what's Jesus telling us here? You allow it to grow and it'll literally kill you. It'll kill your future. It'll kill your joy. It'll kill your relationships. It'll kill everything about you. Amen. I tell you, the devil would love to bury you in it. That's what he's trying to do. Trying to bury you in these caskets from the sycamine tree. Bitterness and unforgiveness are deadly, folks. That's what Jesus is telling us about it right here. When he's comparing it to this sycamine tree, a tree that they'd get the wood to build them caskets with. Harboring bitterness will spiritually bury you more quickly than anything else. If you permit bitterness and unforgiveness to grow in your life, it won't be long until these attitudes have killed your joy, stolen your peace, canceled out your spiritual life. That's a quote from Rick Renner. You know, Rick Renner's a Greek scholar. Spirit-filled, tongue-talking. He's our missionary to Russia. And if you don't know who he is, find out who he is. You ought to know him because he's one of our missionaries. We highlight him several times, at least a couple of times a year. We highlight what he's doing there in Russia on Mission Sunday. Hallelujah. Number four, we're talking about the characteristics of the sycamine tree. It does not pollinate naturally. This is weird. It spreads through the sting of a wasp. A wasp sticks its stinger right into the heart of the fruit of that sycamine tree. Think about that. Its fruit had to be stung in order to reproduce. You ever heard someone say, I've been stung by that person once, but I'm not going to be stung again? What they did hurt me so badly that I will never let him get close enough to sting me again. When you let bitterness and unforgiveness stay in your life, the devil has put his stinger in you. Now, number five, the fifth characteristic, the sycamine tree. Oh, I'm telling you, I'm getting sicker and sicker of sycamine. Amen? Its fruit was only eaten by poor people. Now, as I said before, the sycamine tree and the mulberry tree are very similar in appearance. They are really in the same family of trees. But the two trees even produce a fruit that looks almost identical. But the sycamine tree fruit was extremely bitter. Extremely bitter. The mulberry fruit was delicious and therefore expensive, primarily eaten by the wealthier people there in Israel. And the sycamine fruit was so bitter that it couldn't be eaten whole. They had to nibble on it a little bit at a time. The poor people couldn't afford the good fruit, was having to eat this sycamine fruit. Well, let me tell you, you ain't poor, and you don't have to eat sycamine fruit. Amen? They had to nibble on it a little bit at a time. It was too tart, pugnant to eat at one sitting. And Jesus is letting us know that like the sycamine fruit, the fruit of bitterness and unforgiveness is bitter, it's tart, it's pugnant. Most people who are bitter and filled with unforgiveness chew on their feelings for a long time. They reflect deeply on that offense. Now remember, Jesus said, it's impossible for offenses not to come. Well, I don't like people. I'm just going to be a hermit. I don't care if you go. It's going to still come. God might have to send a bear or something to you there in the woods where you're being a hermit, living in as a hermit in the woods. He may have, whatever, you know, they gonna come. Jesus says it's impossible for them not to come. But he's telling us we don't have to take them. We don't have to take them. Amen. And people that do, you know, they just reflect deep. They return to the memory table to start nibbling on bitterness again. See, the fruit of your offense can bring poverty into your life. Fruit was only eaten by poor people. Now, we're going to talk in here just a moment. We're going to talk about how to get rid of it. A little bit more, how to get rid of it. How many want to get rid of it? Amen. How many don't want no sycamine trees in your life? Bitterness and unforgiveness. You know, we're believers. Amen. This is why we gotta do what the Lord says. We gotta put on love. We gotta walk in love towards one another and towards those in the world. See? And folks, we're living in a time here in America when there is so much torment, fraction, division in the lives of people in America, of all places. And we as believers, we have got to do what the Lord says, and we've got to be examples to those in the world that, hey, we can get along. Amen? But you know, in America, you even got believers fighting and fussing against believers. All kind of all kind of problems causing it. Political. Culture. Racial. We could just go on and on and on and on. We can't let that happen in the body of Christ. Yes, we're in this world, but we're not of this world, but we're ambassadors for Christ in this world. And yes, you ought to, in America, you ought to go vote. And you ought to vote according to the principles of your Constitution, the Word of God. The policies, do their policies line up with the Word of God? And I'll stand in this pulpit and always tell you that because that's the truth. This is what God expects of us. But if you don't, I still love you. And God still loves you. And He'll forgive you. And He'll forgive me. Amen? Glory to God. We got to stay in unity. And love is what keeps us in unity. Love is that bond. Amen? Our faith can't be in any kind of politician. Our faith is in God. Now, we are instructed, and this is what I shared with those ministers in that ministerial association. We're told in the Word of God, we're to pray for all people. And then he implies, especially for those in authority. And you know, he told the church that when the church in the world was under the worst rule, the worst dictator, one of the worst anyway, if not the worst, Nero. You don't think he's bad? Go Google Nero, Caesar. Terrible man. And God says, pray for those in authority. Well, you know, the Bible says that God can take whoever's in authority and turn their hearts like He does a river or streaming water. He can turn their hearts. Amen? But He's told us to pray for them. He didn't told us to criticize them. He's told us to pray for them. And we as a church have got to show the example to the world. Amen? We've got to stay in unity in the love of God. And we've got to pray for them. Amen? We're instructed to. You know why we need to pray for them? That's 1 Timothy chapter 2. See, I know where it's at. 1 Timothy chapter 2. Verse 1 says, therefore I exhort first of all the supplications, that is prayers, asking, that's what it means. Supplication means asking. Prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, now this is why we should do it, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Amen. So, we got to get rid of, regardless of what caused it, what kind of offense it was, we cannot harbor bitterness and unforgiveness against anyone. Amen. And we've got to learn that when that offense comes, because it's impossible for it not to come, because there's still a devil out here working with a host of help. Amen. And always remember, we fight not against flesh and blood. It's what's motivating that flesh and blood that we're supposed to be fighting. Because we understand something they can't understand out there. Natural man cannot understand spiritual things, but we're supposed to be able to understand spiritual things. Amen? And we're not fighting against that flesh and blood that you don't like, whoever it may be, whatever they may have done to you. But it's principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. That's what we're fighting against. And that's what motivates people. That's why he motivates Christians. But we're not supposed to be letting them things motivate us. We're supposed to be being motivated by the Holy Ghost. Amen? He's spirit, but he's holy. And we can't let one of them spirits out there that ain't holy motivate us, you know, to talk ugly to folks, be ugly to folks. Amen? Do wrong things to folks. We have to forgive folks. You know, just think about Joseph. What was done to Joseph? Sold into slavery by his brothers. Then accused of a sexual sin he wasn't guilty of. Thrown into prison. But he never took the offenses. He stayed truthful to his God. And the favor of God stayed upon him. Made him the second in command in the nation of Egypt. And God had him there for the purpose of being able to store up grain where the world, and especially the Israelites, would not starve to death. Amen. Joseph. Job. What happened to Job when he forgave his, he prayed for his friend? And them, you know, I don't want many friends like that. I don't know where you want them or not, but I just don't want them kind of friends. But he prayed for his friends, and God healed him. Amen. And the best example we've got Stephen over there in the book of Acts. They were actually, all he done was give them the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And they stoned him to death. And as they were stoning him to death, he said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And that's the same thing. Our Lord, who is the best example of all, when he was hanging there on the cross, his tormentors, his executors, he said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Well, it's tough. I know. Pastors know. I mean, pastors are lied about. You know what I've seen with pastors? If they take those offenses and keep those offenses, you know, they'll end up out of the ministry. Destroyed. And that's what the devil is trying to do. That's why pastors and ministers, you know, they come against so. Amen. And you are too. If you're a believer, you're going to be come against. The devil's going to try to get everybody against you he can. To discourage you, yeah. Well, bless God, we don't have to keep them sycamine trees. Amen. So how do we get rid of it? How do we get rid of bitterness and unforgiveness? We use our faith. Jesus told us there in the 17th chapter of Luke, he said, if you even have faith, even as small as a grain of mustard seed. Now, we've got all the faith that Jesus has got because we're in Christ spiritually. But we have to get it manifested. So what we're talking about here is what degree of faith and we get manifested to deal with these things. He says, well, if you just have faith as small as a mustard seed, the smallest seed there is, I assume, or at least was at that time, they knew about. He said, if you would just have a faith as small as a mustard seed, well, that little mustard seed could produce a big tree. You can say to this sycamine tree, can say to any kind of mountain in your life that the enemy has brought to your life. You can say, be thou removed and be thou cast into sea. And when it comes to root bitterness and unforgiveness, we can say, I pluck you up from the roots and I cast you into the sea. Amen. We use our faith. We have to use our faith to get everything manifested into our life. Amen. Hallelujah. So, these sycamine trees, they cannot grow in an atmosphere of faith. See? How does faith come? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Have you been hearing this morning? I've been trying to my best to share what the Word of God says with you, to you, concerning these things. I believe faith came to you. Amen? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So I believe we can get rid of any kind of bitterness or unforgiveness against anybody in our life and cast that sycamine trees into the sea of God's forgiveness. You know, he says he'll cast our sins into the sea of forgetfulness. Amen. Hallelujah. And they'll come, if you'll do this in faith, there'll come a time when you won't even remember these things that was done to you. Isn't that wonderful? God is good. God is all powerful. Amen. And once we cast it into the sea, every time that person's name or face comes before you, what are you going to do? What you going to do? You're going to say, I bless them, Lord, and I want you to bless them, Lord. Just bless the socks off of them, God. And if that don't work, then you may have to do something good for them. Amen. That takes faith, don't it? Hallelujah. I can't remember where Brother Hagin, who it was. Somebody was criticizing, some other minister was criticizing him. I think he was on the radio with him. He was coming on either after or before Brother Hagin, and he just tried to tear down everything Brother Hagin said and when he come on the radio. And Brother Hagin just finally, he got fed up with it, and he just sat down and wrote that guy a check for his radio ministry and sent it to him. Said, I want to bless you with this radio ministry. You know what happened? That guy quit criticizing Brother Hagin. He become one of his donors. Amazing what a money will do, isn't it? When you bless somebody with money, it'll shut the devil up real quick. See? Yes, we need to be blessed where we can be a blessing. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, I'm not saying if you disagree with that politician that you need to sit down and write him a check. Amen. But you can pray for him. You say, God bless him. Open their eyes, Lord. Bless them. Because I want some peace in my life, Lord. Amen. I want some peace and liberty in my country where I can freely share the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. How many gave out some of them cards this week? Hey, a few hands went up. Thank you. What the rest of y'all waiting on? We got plenty of them cards. You don't have to save them. We're supposed to give them away. Moving right on here. We're talking about keeping these sycamine trees out of our yard, aren't we? Getting them out of the yard and keeping them out of the yard. Amen? Well, if you're ready, I want you to stand to your feet. We're going to deal with this. I don't know about you, but I'm sick of mine.